Hello, I'm Tom Sorrells, WPDE's chief meteorologist. On behalf of the American Red Cross and WPDE-TV 15, I'd like to thank you for purchasing this tape, because proceeds from your purchase will go to the Hugo Relief Fund. What you're about to see is a historical account of Hugo and some of the raw footage shot by WPDE videographers and others. I sincerely hope you enjoy this tape and hope it will serve as a history book in the years to come. From all of us here at WPDE, we wish you a speedy recovery from the destruction that has interrupted our normally peaceful lives. By the time Hugo made landfall, it was the largest hurricane to strike the U.S. mainland in 4 years. Hugo began, as all of our hurricanes do, off the coast of Africa. On Monday, September 11th, Hugo became Hugo, the tropical storm. Wednesday, the 13th, found Hugo a hurricane. By Friday, the 15th, Hugo reached its zenith with winds of 150 miles an hour. In the next 3 days, Hugo nailed Guadeloupe, then Puerto Rico, then on to the East Coast. On Wednesday, the 20th, the National Hurricane Center issued a hurricane watch for our area. That night on Action News, Hurricane Center Director Bob Sheets was cautiously optimistic.
And we see the probabilities are essentially the same from Jacksonville all the way through the Wilmington area, 19%, 21%, 15%. So indeed, we can't really zoom in on that yet, and we'll have to do a little more of that when the hurricane warning goes up tomorrow.
24 hours later, the optimism was gone. Bob, tell us about Hugo. It's grown this afternoon. How big is he now?
Well, indeed it has grown because it's gotten a little larger. The eye has sort of tightened up and the winds have increased. Now we're looking at a Category 4 hurricane. The winds up to the northeast of there have spread out. They've gotten stronger. And unfortunately, you and Myrtle Beach are in the path of this major hurricane.
The eye of the storm tore through Charleston, then on to the northwest, through Sumter and Camden, then on to Charlotte. The damage in the PD was extensive, as anyone can remember. Several tornadoes are suspected to have touched down, but few were confirmed due to the cover most people had taken and the fact the storm moved through the area at night. Categorically speaking, Hugo was a level 4 hurricane. Only three hurricanes in the 80s have been bigger: Gloria, Allen, and Gilbert. It's been 35 years since we've had this much destruction on our coast. Hopefully, it will be another three decades before we suffer this much again. During the storm, WPDE-TV 15 stayed on the air continuously and aired special broadcasts one day after the storm and another one the following week. The following portion of your tape is made from segments of those two shows and from live broadcasts that aired during the storm.
Action News is everywhere.
Now, from the Eastern Carolinas live news leader, this is WPDE's Action News 15.
It's been a week most of us will always remember.
And the name Hugo is one we will probably never forget.
Good evening, everybody. I'm Bob Howick.
And I'm Lily Shaw. And this is Hugo, picking up the pieces.
We go live to reporter Eric Chilton, who is standing by. Myrtle Beach, we have the latest there. Eric, what can you tell us?
Well, Wayne, right now, I'm sure you can see this. The wind is really picking up. Although looks are deceiving, it doesn't look like it.
We'd like to remind people that evacuation plans have been put into effect for the entire coast.
It may be hard to believe, but this trickle of water could become a raging path of destruction if Hurricane Hugo hits.
We would like to remind you, we do have a line set up for the latest information on Hurricane Hugo. It is 661-HUGO.
The path of Hurricane Hugo, let's take a satellite view of it. As it does approach, of course, strong storm, tropical storm winds will be approaching as we are already beginning to feel the front edge, and we have been getting some showers activity from the very front edge of Hurricane Hugo.
We understand there are only four routes out of Myrtle Beach area, and one of them has been blocked due to an accident. We're told that Highway 76 at the PD River Bridge is now blocked due to an accident which involves several cars. There are no injuries, thankfully.
Winds now on the immediate coast where I am, about 30 miles an hour, gusting up to around the 40 mile an hour range. You asked about evacuations, Roger. They are well underway.
At this hour, Governor Campbell has called a state of emergency. He's asked everyone to leave from along the South Carolina coast. Traffic at this hour is backed up on Highway 501. Sue Abrams joined us now live. Sue, what can you tell us down there?
Well, Roger, as you can see, the winds are very, very high out here. Unbelievable. And if we can look over my shoulder at the pier behind me, you can see the waves are just lapping at the top of that pier already.
Not only are the wind speeds picking up to 125 miles an hour, but the forward progress of the storm moving to the northwest has also picked up. It's now moving in excess of 20 miles an hour.
You're looking now at a live shot of the Grand Strand where surfers are supposedly enjoying some of the swells that you might possibly see in Hawaii and some of the other parts of the nation. Have you noticed the conditions really worsening to the fact that we might be the top probability?
Yes, I would say just in the last half hour or so, it's very difficult for me to even stand up. I have no idea how high the winds are right here.
Once again, that is a live shot out of the ocean front, and you can see from our exclusive vantage point of how the haze and the fog looks kind of misty, how it's rolling in and...
Good evening, everybody. I'm Bob Howick.
And I'm Lily Shaw. Folks up and down the Carolina coast are bracing themselves for what could be the worst storm since Hazel in 1954.
Our news teams have been keeping an eye on things along the Grand Strand. Sue Abrams is in the Pavilion area, right in the heart of Myrtle Beach. Obviously not an activity center at the moment. Sue?
That's exactly right, Bob. Well, just since the last half hour has elapsed since we last talked, the winds have picked up dramatically.
Bob, tell us about Hugo. It's grown this afternoon. How big is he now?
Well, indeed it has grown because it's gotten a little larger. The eye has sort of tightened up and the winds have increased. Now we're looking at Category 4 hurricane. The winds up to the northeast of there have spread out. They've gotten stronger. And unfortunately, you and Myrtle Beach are in the path of this major hurricane.
Reports from throughout the city show most, if not all, Florence area motels and hotels are filled to capacity, not to mention those outside Florence County limits.
Bob, it looks like it's going to be a long night here at Socrates High School.
All right, sir. Stay safe and stay dry.
Imagine, if you will, this is your favorite hotel. For example, let's call it, say, the Yachtsman. As the storm moves in, the high tide is going to surge up on top of it and perhaps cover a portion of the hotel or the building or the pavilion or whatever building is there on Ocean Boulevard. And then the waves on top of that will act as almost like a wrecking ball crashing on top of it.
Definitely things are getting worse. I think we're going to be seeing a lot of changes going on here in the next few hours. And the best bet, just stay home and please stay tuned. We'll have all the latest information.
The power has gone out from Cherry Grove down to Atlantic Beach. Now that would encompass the area where North Myrtle Beach Middle School is at.
As I recall from the last time a hurricane came inland in this area, city officials in various municipalities throughout Horry County actually made decisions to cut power so that fire risk were minimized.
Some people think that it may be kind of odd that we're talking about tornadoes and yet we got a hurricane bearing down on us. The hurricane spawns the tornadoes.
Eye of the storm is now covering Charleston, South Carolina. On the radar, the intensity of the storm is not showing up just very well because it's so far away in some of the areas, but the eye is clearly defined. You can tell just how massive that eye is as it encircles the whole area to the north and to the east of Charleston.
If you are one of the very lucky people who still has power, by all means, under no circumstances, come outside here. It is very, very dangerous.
During the past hour and a half, it has made steady progress from Charleston and is continuing to move to the north by northwest. The eye of the storm now looks like it will probably go to the west of Florence on a path that will take it right into Charlotte, North Carolina. We'll be back in another 30 minutes.
Governor Campbell is touring the state by helicopter to begin community damage assessment. The governor told Action News he had no idea the destruction would be this extensive.
Total destruction of some of the small homes and mobile homes. I mean, just complete annihilation. Nothing there. Just like a huge tornado had just torn it to pieces. Was not something I think that either one of us thought we would see.
Hit the south end last night, it was obvious this was one of the most severe storms the area had ever seen. But looking at devastation this morning, that truth became even more evident. The south end is known for its flooding in low-lying areas, and that fact, coupled with 30-foot tidal surges, spelled disaster for all areas of the Strand.
If we don't get sewer and water squared away to the liking of the Department of Health, then we can't let people back in until that's squared away, and at this point, I don't know when that will be.
The sad truth is that when some of these folks return to their homes, all that will be left are scattered memories.
Tempers raged earlier today in Myrtle Beach. Hundreds of residents tried to get to their homes to check out the damage. The closest they got was to Waccamaw Pottery before meeting up with the National Guard. Authorities say they were trying to prevent looting, but that wasn't good enough for many Grand Strand citizens.
They're checking other people's houses, but we can't get in to check ours, which is not fair.
I've been here since about 6:45. I just want to go to my house and see what condition my property's in, clean out my freezer, and leave.
Some residents waited as long as 8 and 9 hours before getting clearance. Many say next time there's bad weather, they won't evacuate. President Bush this morning declared South Carolina a disaster area. The declaration makes the state eligible for loans that will provide housing, grants, and low-interest loans to cover insured losses to private properties and businesses.
Jim and Janice Wilson are very thankful today. Thankful that they and their 20-month-old baby made it through Hurricane Hugo relatively unharmed.
Well, the wind started blowing real heavy, and I looked out the window, and the trees was waving back and forth. And about 2:30, 3 o'clock, we noticed one tree had fell, and it came through the roof of my house, and I was inside. And next thing I knew, looked out the other window, and all the other trees started falling, and I looked out, and it fell on a couple of my automobiles here, and this was about 3:30 this morning.
While the eye of the storm didn't come through our area, strong winds did knock down trees, blocking roads and damaging homes. And with the damage being so widespread, residents knew they had to begin cleaning up on their own.
This is a neighborhood project. Anytime anything happens like this, the neighbors come together. And we decided that if we did have an emergency, we wanted a street so the fire trucks, ambulance, whatever could come down.
One of the hardest hit parts around Florence was the hotel area near the intersection of I-95 and Highway 52. These hotels were jam-packed with people who fled the coast in search of safer ground. Little did they realize that Hugo would rip the roof off the Travelers Inn and throw it into the parking lot. Many cars were damaged, but no people were seriously injured.
A lot of noise, a lot of wind, the trees were bending, you know, pretty bad. Sounded like freight trains were hitting us. We ran into the bathroom after we boarded up the window, and our roof caved in on us and was slowly torn off. I mean, it was phenomenal. You could just hear like a wind and then pieces flying and hitting. You know, you couldn't see anything if you looked out the window because it was dark, but you could hear things, and I mean, you weren't sure what or where it was going, whether it was a car or a roof or whatever.
For now, many people are still in a state of shock, waiting for the electricity to come on and gearing up for the long process of rebuilding.
Charleston, once a city bursting with culture, is now struggling to survive. In just about every corner, remnants of Hugo's wrath are clear and hard cut.
It got to the calm part, and the second part was worse than the first part. But I'm just glad it didn't stop over the city or anything, it just kept going.
Some were and still are amazed by the devastation.
There's another boat up here in the marsh.
Others cry out in pain.
Oh, Lord!
What?
Look at the house!
National Guardsmen have helped create a warlike atmosphere. Rioting and looting are a constant threat, so curfews and strict rules are enforced in an attempt to idle those dangers. Lack of water and food has many nearing the breaking point. Power is still a rare commodity. About 15 miles from the city, the Isle of Palms looks like an underwater battlefield, with damage estimates still climbing. Other nearby islands are overcome with demolished homes and piles of debris and twisted memories. In McClellanville, rumors of newly discovered bodies have sparked more anger and disbelief. Although no one in the small fishing town is confirmed dead, emergency crews fear the worst as they plow through the rubble. It may take as long as a month before McClellanville regains power. Throughout Charleston and Berkeley counties alone, at least 5 are known dead. Still, the light of hope burns eternal. This morning, President Bush toured the desolate city and signed a $1.1 billion piece of legislation that will give emergency aid to Charleston and the rest of the state.
Good luck to you.
Thank you very much.
It's nice to know that somebody cares and they're
here. I'm so impressed
about
your spirit.
Truckloads of supplies are pouring in from throughout the state and across the nation. Even in cities hard hit like Florence, residents are donating food, clothing, and money to help Charlestonians get through the daily task of survival. It's items like these that are making a difference for thousands of residents. But far too many people in and around the area are still finding it difficult to get by. And with the situation the way it is now, hard times will continue plaguing the area. Those working to reestablish a sense of beauty and stability say it may take months, even years, before the cultural beauty that was once Charleston's is fully restored. However long it takes, have no doubt, Hugo's rage has planted seeds of devastation never to be uprooted.
Our company linemen in downtown Sumter were a welcome sight. 60% of the city was still without electricity. An ice truck showed up at a gas station, and people seemed to come out of nowhere to get a bag. No price gouging here. Ice is going for $1 a bag. The Sumter Salvation Army set up 2 mobile feeding sites. Power was supplied by a generator.
We've served over 6,000 meals already to people, to the workers here that's cleaning up, and National Guard, and also people coming in getting food. We're serving breakfasts, lunch, and supper around the clock.
Even though the rain is making it more miserable in Sumter, the Salvation Army says getting along is the key to everything.
Seems like today we've got even more than what we had yesterday, to be honest with you, coming in here lining up for food and also coming in to donate food where we can prepare for the people that's coming on the spot here.
Downtown Sumter was just about completely trashed. National Guardsmen teamed up with airmen from Shaw Air Force Base to discourage looters. 20 miles southeast, the Clarendon County seat of Manning also looked like it was on wartime footing. Instead of military personnel, though, contract power crews roamed the streets. The Clarendon County Courthouse suffered some minor damage, but was open for business. Manning City workers stood guard over stores with blown out windows. Lake City had power, but its major industry took it on the chin. Hugo ripped the roofs off just about every tobacco warehouse in town. Planner's warehouse facade collapsed, leaving valuable tobacco exposed to drenching rains. One warehouseman said, at least we didn't lose anybody.
The south end of Polly's Island is like a war zone, with houses ravaged by winds and storm surges of up to 20 feet. What's left is next to nothing. Homes are open to the stares of strangers, outsiders brought in to work, watch, and protect. The feet of sand has shifted over what was a road, and farther south, the inlet separating Polly's Island from land has broken a new path, cutting the south end in two.
Although bulldozing this inlet with extra sand is a good possibility, there's a question of whether that effort will hold the high volume of water.
There could well be a battle with Coastal Council over how to bridge that gap. Open sewers leave an incredible stench that worsens in the heat of the day. And after the shock of first seeing the destruction fades, it's evident any degree of routine life on Polly's south end lies in the distant future.
We've got to cut and cap the cable, really just to take the service out of this end, because we're taking hits in our central office. We project we'll probably have service back in here about 8 months, if we're lucky.
The one man working where his own house was destroyed still has room for optimism.
Talking to the Corps of Engineers this morning, and things appear to be much worse than what we think they are, so maybe the lattice rebuild and we'll come back.
Look for us.
Hugo has taught us all a great lesson, a lesson of compassion, of humility, and a lesson of humbleness. As our world quickly turned upside down, there came an outpouring of help from all across the United States. Neighbors helped neighbor, strangers became friends, and friends became closer. The one thing we learned is as inhabitants of this normally gentle earth, we're but a small part of the overall scheme of things. No destruction is final, and we can and did weather the storm.
Hurricane Hugo wreaked havoc across South Carolina, leaving behind a scar that may never mend. The staff and management of WPDE-TV15 wishes to express our deepest sympathy to those suffering the loss of loved ones and to the thousands experiencing property damage caused by this tremendous storm. We'd also like to express our gratitude to the many citizens of this great area volunteering their time and efforts, reaching out to help those in need. It is with much pride that we, the staff and management of WPDE-TV15, serve you.
closer I got to the house, I have butterflies in my stomach. I really had a sad feeling. But just seeing that my house is standing, you know, I feel like I'm very lucky when you look out and see all these other people. It's really bad, really bad. Because the ocean water was inside the house.
I'm not the only one, just thankful that there's no life lost in this general area, and it, then we'll rebuild, we'll come back, and it's going to take a while. But talking to the Corps of Engineers this morning, and things appear to be much worse than what we think they are, so maybe they'll let us rebuild and we'll come back.
Came around the corner, I saw the corner of the house, and I said, wow, the house is still here. And then when we got closer, we saw a dumpster run through the windows here. And I had to hold her. She was ready to fall down crying.
What we're beginning to worry about now is how long will it take it to pass through our inland areas? I keep getting calls from people who live in mobile homes. They're worried about tomorrow morning. How soon do you think it'll pass out of our area?
Passing out of your area will take at least 12 to 24 hours. We're looking at, again, a few more hours to get to the coast. And then if we look here, you can see the size of tropical storm force winds, the size of hurricane force winds, and that's going to have to move right on through your area. So it's going to be at least 12 hours from after it passes over you.
Okay, Bob, one last question. Everyone here remembers Hazel from 1954. How do you figure that Hugo will stack up against Hazel in a historical perspective? What are we in store for here?
If we're correct, it'll be as strong or stronger and as devastating as Hazel was, because it has the larger wind field out there to the northeast, and it also is coming in nearly parallel to the coast as compared to turning. Now, this may start to turn, and if that happens, that will help, but not a whole lot.
Okay, Dr. Sheets, we appreciate you staying with us throughout the day today. We'll talk to you a little later.
The noise, we could hear these precise snaps of buildings leaving the foundations and pieces, refrigerators, etc., crashing into stuff.
I'm probably one of the few people in this world that don't carry insurance. I have no insurance, zero.
We were scared. We at first didn't realize it was actually going to hit us, because so many times they'll start in the shore and then they'll turn around and go somewhere else, but this one just kept on coming. And at first we thought it was going to be Savannah, which they kept telling, but then it kept getting more northernmost. So we ended up moving because we did get scared.
People got it a lot worse than us, and you know, we feel for those people. And you know, I really would think that most people are more concerned about those who have gotten nothing.
Well, I think the president had to see it firsthand to believe the degree of devastation that Hurricane wrought on South Carolina. He was very impressed with the spirit of the people that we stopped and talked to. And I think the president is committed to do everything he can to give us the federal resources and assets to make them available to help us begin a slow, long process of rebuilding.
Blew this big billboard off of its foundation right across the highway, and that was like, you know, I said then, this thing is really, really happening here, and that's when it really came to, I really came to grips with it, and a transformer, as we were still traveling down, a transformer blew up on a light pole, and it made this big, look like a fire was on top of the light pole, and
because this morning, I walked around and I was looking at the other pine trees that's in the yard. I said, we need to top these. We need to get rid of them, do something. So, but yeah, it's definitely something you worry about anytime the wind gets up now.
Hurricane Hugo has come and gone and somehow left a mark on all of us here in the Carolinas. But something beautiful has come from the storm. After the End, an album by Hans Christian. After the End is a symphony inspired by this vicious child of Hazel. After the End has been released by Strand Records, but is not available in your record stores. A percentage of all proceeds will be donated to the Red Cross Hurricane Hugo Relief Fund. For your copy of Hans Christian After the End, call Strand Records toll-free at 1-800-637-1670. That's 1-800-637-1670.
From A to Z, TV 15 Action News is there for you.
And I think when all the dust is settled and the debris removed, people are going to understand that this has been a total team effort.
Working hard, whatever it takes. Whenever it matters, you've always been.
Somebody cares and they're
I'm
here.
I'm so impressed
Thank
about
you
your
again.
Spirit.